staff ready?
Yeah, it is.
Having a quorum present, I'll call to the order the April 24th meeting of the Historic Landmarks Commission. First item on the agenda is public comment. Seeing no public, I will close public comment and go to approval of the minutes of the Historic Landmarks Commission meeting of April 10th, 2013. Somebody?
So moved.
Second.
Motion by Lavoy, second by Arias. Under discussion, any additions, corrections, clarifications on the minutes?
Mr. Chair?
Yes, Mr. Lavoy.
On page 7, item 4, La Entrada in the motion. Number 3, some areas are still too contemporary. We talked about both architecture and site plan. I think that needs to be clarified.
Mm-hmm. We can add that clarification.
Okay. Anything else?
No.
Anybody else? Okay. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Aye. Opposed? Abstain? Suiting abstains from item 4. Motion carries. Next item on the agenda is the consent calendar. Ms. Gantz.
Yes, Mr. Chair. April 24th. Just one moment, please.
Sure. Technical difficulties. Do you want to table and come back to it?
Yeah, let's do that.
Okay. Are you ready for announcements? Or do you want to table that?
Yes.
Well?
No, I can give announcements.
Just table the whole meeting and we'll go home.
Yeah, here they are. Yes. Okay, sorry.
That's all right.
Commissioner Murray.
A nice day out there.
Ms. Gantz.
Thank you. Commissioner Murray will be absent today. And then Commissioners Boucher and Sharp will be leaving at the conclusion of item 5. And with those commissioners absent, that will leave 6 commissioners.
As it stands today, it will leave 5 because Schallenberger is not here right now.
Right now, he's not. He's supposed to be coming in, but he might be leaving. He wants to leave at 4 o'clock. So what I'm saying is we don't want to lose a quorum for the last item because there are people coming from out of town. It's a city project, item 7. So whoever says they're going to stay, you need to stay.
Oh, I feel sick, Kevin.
Okay. Yeah, no, nobody can get sick.
Nice try.
Yeah, me too.
And that's all
nice
I have.
Okay.
Are there any City Council or Planning Commission upcoming items that the Historic Landmarks Commission should be aware of? Ms. Weiss?
Hi. Betty Weiss, just to briefly update you, we did hold a joint meeting of the Planning Commission and City Council last week. And it's a review of major workload items in the planning division. Because of all the recent activity regarding the Historic Resources Work Program, we really didn't cover that as a principal topic at the work session, but it was noted as an important project we're working on. We did review implementation of the general plan, the status on a number of projects that are underway there, as well as we discussed looking into amending the city's hedge ordinance. As you all, I believe, know, it's been suspended, certain sections of that, for enforcement since 2008. And that suspension is due to expire next year. And so we were asking the commission and the council about their interest in looking at amending that ordinance. I believe you all were sent a link to the staff report materials for that meeting last week. And if you have a chance to look at them, I think both those topics could be of interest to this commission as well.
It's even more fascinating. Pardon me, Ms. Senate, Mr. Weiss. It's even more fascinating to watch it on television.
Right. You could watch, exactly.
It's a lively
discussion,
for sure.
Watch the meeting, yeah, particularly on the hedges.
Yeah.
And that's even better probably than reading the report. They're both good. But then on the Historic Resources Work Program, probably Ms. Hernandez, if you weren't updated at the last meeting, she can give you the update on Ordinance Committee and designations. Thanks.
Thank you, Ms. Weiss. Ms. Hernandez?
Yes, we did go back to the Ordinance Committee for the second meeting last Tuesday. And that meeting, the Ordinance Committee agreed with our recommendations.
Okay.
And we're moving on to drafting an outline of the new ordinance.
So making progress.
Very well, yes. It was a great discussion. In addition, I have two other announcements.
Go right ahead.
We have sent notices to the proposed historic districts of West Beach, West Downtown districts, and the Bungalow Haven, that they will be added to the potentials list because they were identified in the surveys. Before those hearings, we are, as we've discussed in previous meetings, going to have two neighborhood meetings to answer their questions about what that entails.
Have those been scheduled?
Yes, I have a flyer for you.
Do you want to just read the announce the dates, please?
The dates are Thursday, May 9th at 5:30 to 7 here in the Gephardt Room, and Saturday, May 11th in the morning from 10 to 11:30 at the Faulkner Gallery.
And those are for both districts?
For all of them, yes.
Okay.
So trying to be as accessible as we can. We had discussed that the several commissioners attend the meetings, and we would like to review the agenda. I have a meeting with the commissioners that want to attend those meetings and review the agenda. Perhaps May 8th before the commission hearing at 11 a.m.
Okay. So are you asking for volunteers?
Yes.
Okay. I'll let you volunteer or you'll be drafted.
I'll volunteer.
Okay. Do we have another one? It looks like we probably need three or four because there's two meetings.
Yes.
I would think Fermina would be interested in doing it.
Okay. I'm going to draft Fermina and Mr. Winnick.
Okay. And what are the dates?
Thursday, May 9th and Saturday, May 11th.
Yes. And we were going to have a pre-meeting, so we all are on go over the agenda on May 8th before the commission at 11 a.m.
Okay.
The commission meets at 1, if that works.
Okay.
And we also need another commission, new committee. Now, we're drafting the new guidelines to accompany the new districts.
Mm-hmm.
And we need a commission committee to review
them.
Three.
Wow. Well, again, I'm going to suggest that Commissioner Murray be on it, Commissioner Schallenberger, and Commissioner Drury.
I can do that.
As an alternate or as a fourth, Commissioner Lavoie.
That would be great.
Since I've done that before.
Yeah, and Commissioner Lavoie might be, pardon me for the expression, but might be more useful than Schallenberger just because Lavoie has
experience.
Just because Lavoie has had experience in it.
Yes.
That's being the only reason.
I'll send you an email with some.
And try to coordinate the dates with meeting days?
Yes. We'll probably be doing lots of the review via email anyway.
Okay.
So please we'll cross-copy me on those emails,
yes.
too. Please.
Okay.
Anything else?
I think Jaime has some announcements as well.
Okay. Mr. Lamont? Glad to see you back. And
thank you very,
very
much.
Sorry for your loss.
I know. Thank you for your kind words and your card. Appreciated that. I wanted to follow up on an inquiry that Commissioner Sharp made in the previous week regarding an effort to update the Santa Barbara El Pueblo Viejo book. I think that's a good project and one that is probably long overdue.
Excuse me, Ms. Feliciano, can you change the screen?
And I'll let Mr. Sharp sort of explain the genesis behind this and I'll follow up with what we plan to do.
Mr. Sharp. Thank you. The Santa Barbara Conservancy at our last meeting talked about the need to upgrade and do a second edition of the Santa Barbara El Pueblo Viejo book that is now on the screen. And consequently, I emailed Jaime about the possibility of us doing that, and he was very much in favor. And So we look forward to working with the city who holds the copyright to this book to put out a second edition.
And Mr. Sharp is aware that we have a full plate of things going on right now. So I would like to have us initiate those discussions and hopefully have you run with it and have the key people that would be involved in updating it. We can certainly assist in providing you some mappings and some updates that we know about it, because there is an errata for it, but the errata is even outdated now. So certainly we were also concerned that we didn't have enough copies. We were down to maybe 20 now. And if the commissioners would like a copy, it is available, since it looks like we're going to have a reprint. Now, obviously, there's going to be a cost associated with that, but we're going to talk about budget, so that would be a good time to raise that issue. And I also wanted to let you know that there are some other documents that we give our visitors from other communities and people interested in doing walking tours of the city that are often given, that we're reluctant to distribute these because, again, they're outdated and we have such few. So it would be a great opportunity to get those, to have the community be aware of all these landmarks.
Well, the Conservancy is aware of the manpower shortage with the city, and we are willing to tackle this.
So we do have a tentative meeting scheduled for tomorrow at 1.
Correct.
So whoever you need to invite, Mr. Sharp, goes. We're ready.
I won't be able to. I'm going to be out of town tomorrow, but having been involved with the production of the original one, I want very much to be involved in it.
You will be.
Okay.
Thank you.
I would also like to be involved if you need another warm body.
Thank you.
All right. Any other announcements?
Where will the meeting be tomorrow at 1?
Upstairs in the planning conference room.
All right. I did want to announce that the annual workshop for city advisory groups will be held May 8th at 4:30 in the afternoon at the Faulkner Gallery. Any subcommittee reports? Anyone? None? Then we'll move on to the first item of the agenda, which is item number 1. It's the Community Development Department budget. We have Ms. Weiss, city planner. Welcome, Ms. Weiss.
Thank you. Good afternoon, Historic Landmarks Commissioners. As is customary, we make a stop here at the HLC, as well as other board and commissions in the Community Development Department, each year to review our proposed budget, and that's why I'm here today. The city administrator released the recommended budget to council on April 16th, I provided you with a brief memo with a link to where that budget can be found online, and also noted that the Community Development Department's presentation before council is on Thursday, May 1st at 1 p.m. So what I'd like to review with you today are some highlights of the Community Development Department's portion of that citywide budget, and seek your input, questions, and so forth. Thank you. So here is an organizational chart for our department with administration and Paul Casey's office, and then the primary divisions and programs that we have. The budget is arranged by program, and within our department shown here, we have 14 programs in 6 different funds with a total of 66.35 full-time equivalent staff. Those programs and divisions are an arts program, which is a coordination with the county, the planning division, and of course that's the area I'll be spending a little more time on. We have a small economic development program. We have the new division known now as Housing and Human Services. That division used to also have the redevelopment program within it. It does still retain the Community Development Block Grant Administration, Human Services, Rental Housing Mediation, the RDA, or Redevelopment Successor Agency responsibilities, and Housing Development and Preservation. And then the other division is Building and Safety, and their programs are Building Inspection, Code Enforcement, Records Archives and Clerical Services, and then the Building Counter and Plan Check. These are the 11 general fund programs, and in planning, we have development environmental review, zoning, design review, and historic preservation, and long-range planning. Here's a pie chart for the department as a whole's budget of $9,776,000+. In the general fund for the department, the planning division is the largest piece of that at 48%, and followed by the building and safety division. Then you can see the smaller amount for the housing and admin at 15%, arts at 4%, and though all economic development shows 0, it's just the dollar amount is relatively small, and so it doesn't show up on the pie. In the general fund for our department, as has occurred citywide, there have been a number of efforts to reduce expenses, control expenses in a variety of ways. For our department, the primary way that's been done is through staff employee costs and employee reductions. So what we show here is from 2009 to present, that the general fund position, so this doesn't include those that were funded by the redevelopment agency, but going from 71.5 to 60, so over the last 4 years, that represents 11.5 positions reduced. Our proposed budget, I'll be reviewing some highlights with you, is essentially status quo in terms of positions officially, but sometimes some positions are held open and not filled, and I have some news on that front. So here's a slide taken from the budget that relates to revenues. I usually like to bring this up in point that the services that you all participate in, there are fees for service, and I think you all want to be aware of, you know, what we're projecting overall, and you may have some questions about what are the fees that we're projecting and revenue for design review and such. So without going into a lot of detail here, what we're saying for this year is we expect to come in pretty close to what it is we projected for this current budget, or maybe a little bit more this budget year we're in right now for 2013. It's always very difficult to estimate the level of activity, and that's become even more difficult with the drop in activity, and we believe we're coming out of it. There's a number of indicators such that we do believe that, but again, at what pace, at how much? So we have a fairly conservative estimate for the recommended 2014 budget of approximately 1% over this year.
Just don't stop believing.
Okay. This might be a good time to make note of the city's budget overall, again, which can be found on the website. I think it's always very useful at least to read the letter from Jim Armstrong, the city administrator, because that really provides a great overview from an overall standpoint. And one of the messages is, again, some optimism based on fact in terms of some revenue sources trending towards growth, and an overall approach for the budget as status quo, more or less, and not anticipating increased spending in any too significant ways. As I think you all know, the budget is made up of a number of special or enterprise funds, the general fund, and we also have a capital improvement program. So I'm going to be touching on the capital as well for a minute. Back to fees, the city generally will give across the board departments direction to increasing costs of services as a whole, and so we typically get direction to look at the fees for services that we have in the Community Development and Planning Division, and at this for this budget it was approximately 3%, but we still analyze each service and program to determine whether or not, you know, a 3% makes sense. So just highlighting a couple of things for you. For the last, I think, about 3 years, we've kept the zoning information reports status quo and not increased that fee. We did propose a minor restructuring of that fee, and this is a two-year financial plan for fiscal years 2014, 14 and 15, but it's an actual operating budget only for 2014. So the fee resolution is reviewed each year. I'm anticipating with the zoning information report as a full cost recovery service that we may look to increase it slightly next year, but it's not proposed to increase this year. Modifications, I think you all are familiar with the type of modifications we see because it's noted for you on your agendas and discussed with you with different projects. That fee is, we feel, is comfortable at its current level of recovery, which is somewhere around 50% to 70% cost recovery, so we didn't recommend increasing the modification fee. And then the others listed there, I think, are a lot of detail that you're probably not interested in. But I did make changes to the fee resolution related to specific plans and zone change and transfer of existing development rights. These were all fee categories that are fairly high fee for this particular review. And in looking at them closely, I actually made some adjustments downwards slightly in some of these fees.
That's all we want to know.
Okay. So here are some key budget issues for the Community Development Department. The first one is filling the vacant senior planner's examiner position, and that's in building and safety. And the plan check program there, again, really hard to know what level of activity. We've held this position open for, I think, this whole fiscal year and maybe a little bit before till just now, where the position has recently been filled and we have a new employee in that position. That is a really critical in terms of land development, that service that we provide for property owners to be able to get projects through plan check. Then zoning enforcement hourly help. I think you all will recall from every year that I've been here, as well as just your interaction with staff in terms of our enforcement program. That's one of the planning programs that has really been hit the hardest with all these budget reductions, and we've barely had much in the way of enforcement, but it is getting better. We have recently recruited and are about to announce an appointment of a new staff person in the one enforcement position we have. But what's shown here is we were able to find enough funds in the proposed budget to have $30,000 for hourly support. And we find that extra support, any amount that we can get, this is approximately a part-time employee for the 1 year, will really make a difference in our enforcement program. So that was our top priority for any growth in our budget. Historic Preservation Work Program, you all are aware that when we went to the City Council for that program, we estimated $30,000 as the cost, with primarily this going towards a searchable database and web public information, because public information was definitely a theme throughout the historic resources element. And in updating all the lists and database and surveys and district and so forth, it's really important to have that information up to date and available to the public. So,
do you want questions now or during the end?
I'll try to, in the end.
Okay.
Be best. So that is being recommended for funding at the $30,000 level. Okay, the zoning ordinance update. This is a new thing. This is being proposed as part of the city's capital program. So capital, there are definitions for what is capital, and it's namely, you know, infrastructure is one way to think of capital. But for planning, our zoning ordinance is like infrastructure. And the state of the city's zoning ordinance is not very good. It's based upon its original 1957 codes of the city. It's been amended many times. It doesn't reflect the actual status of our community as a very much built-out community, and it is complicated and difficult to apply consistently. So we put forth a proposal, and it is being recommended that we would undertake an approximately three-year project to do a comprehensive update of the zoning ordinance. So that project, the cost shown there includes approximately 2.5 years of a project planner to manage the project, some funds to support the city attorney's office because their involvement in any ordinance and code update is critical, and they don't really have the current capacity to take on such a major project. We are keeping them very busy with other things like historic districts and such. And then approximately $200,000 for consultant services. In the realm of zoning ordinance updates, consultant services are really critical. We have done a survey of 12 or more communities in California to look at how much they spent, how long did it take, and did they use consultant services. And we think that we will have a better outcome and actually more an efficient process overall with consultant services. So that's what's recommended for that project. Here are additional requests. Not actually included within the Community Development Department's budget, but on the table for the council to consider, given that when Mr. Armstrong and the Finance Department did pull together the budget, there's a small surplus for each year, and they have asked for the department's priorities for use of that surplus, and so we've put forward the Design Review Board and Commission stipends. And so the figure shown there would include the stipends as they were when they were last in effect, which is $25 for consent reviewers and $50 for each board or commissioner attending a regular meeting. And this includes the Historic Landmarks Commission, the ABR, and the Single Family Design Board. So when we are at the presentation on May 1st, it would be advisable. We suggest that you all appoint someone to come to speak on your behalf, or you can also email council members in terms of where you are in terms of your interest on the stipend. As a general rule, we carry forward the message that this is an important more symbolic just recognition of the valuable services that you all provide as volunteers to the city and the community. And it is a little more than symbolic in that it is some monetary amount that we've heard from commissioners just help defray costs. You know, it helps smooth out some edges of your budget and your time, and so that is our top priority for the surplus recommended. We also went ahead and put out there that we could use additional hourly help for enforcement, but I think we have those in priority order shown on the screen here. Also, as you know, the budget, as it's been developed over a number of years now, also includes things what we call P3, the performance program measures. And so on the screen are just some highlights of trying to capture all the work that we're planning on doing in the next fiscal year. And the first one is striving to maintain levels of service in enforcement, zoning information reports, counter and plan check for planning. We have had to lower our targets over the year in terms of what kind of service level we're able to provide the community in that program. We are going to continue to implement the general plan. We are participating in the Senate Bill 375 Sustainable Community Strategy, which is being led by the Santa Barbara County Association of Governments, but that does involve our staff time, and I think you all will be hearing more about that later this year. The Preservation Work Program, and then Land Development and Environmental Review Procedures Improvements. So that concludes my presentation. I'm available for questions and your comments.
Okay, I'll open public comment. One member of the public, Paula Westbury, she basically is in opposition to
everything.
I'm acknowledging a written letter from Ms. Paula Westbury in opposition. I'll close public comment and bring it back to the commission for questions. Commissioner Winnick, do you have any questions? Schallenberger? No. Arias?
No, I
have a
comment.
Okay. Question? Commissioner
no
Lavoie, Sharp?
No.
Boucher? Drury?
I just have one. I think that we, two or three years ago, voluntarily gave up our stipend. I think it was
longer ago than that.
Longer, 4 years?
I think it was maybe three.
I only enjoyed about two paychecks more than that. I don't know if that's I mean, that's, just for this commission alone, it's $900 a month if everybody shows up.
Yeah.
So I don't know. Okay. I would be willing to forego it myself.
All right. Question for Ms. Weiss. Is the historic resource element 30,000 still pretty strong, the promise that council made? You touched on it, but I've been hearing other things that they've been kind of maybe backing down a little bit and saying, we didn't promise it, we said we'd look at it. And that's not what I heard when I was sitting in front of them. So what's your take?
My take is, at the meeting where this was before council,
yes,
they were not making a budgetary decision. So they did all indicate support mm-hmm. for the $30,000, and we have been able to include it in our budget. It is recommended by Mr. Casey and Mr. Armstrong. Mm-hmm. But the budget decision is happening now, and so I think it's a matter of semantics.
Or a matter of timing, really.
Yeah, and timing, discussion, and action. Again, we haven't posed that as a question, like, you know, should we do this any differently than anything we've proposed in our recommended budget? Mm-hmm. The stipends is a different matter. So again,
well, that was my next question: yeah. is the $37K for design review and stipend, that's different
yes,
than
it is.
The $30K, completely different, separated.
Mm-hmm.
We need the $30K for the historic resource element. We need that. That has to get done and put in place. And we, you know, that feel very strongly that the money that is spent on is far more, and I'm speaking just as one commissioner, far more important to the benefit of the public than the stipend or the 37K. And that's just one commissioner's opinion. But the benefit to the public of that 30K to update the historic structures, a searchable database, all of that stuff is extremely important. That was a comment, sorry. Any other comments? Yes, Commissioner Rios.
One of the things that was discussed is the value and importance of volunteers.
Mm-hmm.
And I think that is something that should be continued to be explored and investigated, because there are people in the community that are very, very interested in seeing historic preservation become very a part of this community. I'm on.
Sorry. Speak up.
What?
Speak up.
No, I'm not. The other thing I want to speak about is the enforcement. If we don't have an active enforcement policy, and then we can see projects that come before us that have been, for lack of a better word, polluted with changes and things like that. And so I think enforcement goes hand in hand with historic preservation. And I would like to see that we do have the good enforcement policy going in the city. And I, for one, will give you a little bit of history. When I was on the Planning Commission
years ago
in 1820, through my tax accountant, I took off the cost of being a planning commissioner as a charitable contribution to the city, and I was audited by the government, the federal government. I went to the council and pointed out to them that if they paid us $1 a year, we could take all our expenses off as business. And that was the start of the paying of the commissioners. I, for one, don't need the money. And
must be nice.
what do I got next, you know? I would rather see the city use that money in a way that increases historic preservation. And if there could be a way that we could divert the paychecks of the people who wish to do this into a fund for preservation, that would be fine with me.
Interesting.
You can still keep yours.
No. I think that brings up a good question as well. If that $37K isn't for stipends, where would it go?
The city council... and Paul, I'm not sure, but it's somewhere $400,000 this small amount of surplus.
Right.
And then it's also projected to continue into the next year. So the council, I believe, is open to looking at either one-time expenditures or possibly some ongoing expenditures. But each department throughout the city is recommending a list of possible uses for the surplus funds.
Uh-huh.
I know as well at the joint meeting last week, the mayor mentioned, for example, maybe we could pull together some staff assistance to do an arts master plan similar to the way the staff supported the historic resources element. Mm-hmm. And so that was one idea she had. On. So there are going to be a number of ideas on how the $400,000 could be spent.
I'm sure they're
it's my understanding that you've already recommended that $37K be used for stipend, or is that not? You had it high on your list of priorities.
The,
has that been recommended or not been recommended?
This area of how to possibly add to or change to the budget really hasn't been discussed yet.
Okay.
The for our department, when we're at City Hall Council on May 1st,
right,
we will put that out there. Each department will, I believe, as they go through their presentations, and then as the council deliberates on the budget as a whole,
uh-huh,
prior to them adopting it in June, they will have had the full discussion of the various options.
Okay. So say they do allocate the $37K to design review stipend, and then the design review boards and commissions decide that they don't want a stipend and they would want that money to go to something else that would benefit the public or benefit their group as a whole. If that $37K was allocated as stipend money, what happens to it if it's not used as stipend money? Or is it even up to
someone else gets to spend it?
Yeah, is it even up to the commissions and the boards to say that they don't want a stipend? And that they want that money spent. I guess maybe we need to put it out there before it happens.
Correct. Chair Suiting, I'd follow up on Ms. Weiss's comment as well. Council also has the option not to expend any of that approximate $400,000 and kind of have a
sure
conservative budget
sure
and keep it. And actually, I think that's what Mr. Armstrong is probably going to recommend, but says if you wish to expand some services in some other areas, here are some options that the departments have kind of brainstormed. And so that's where the stipend comes into that mix. I guess what we would ask for you today is if you don't think the stipends are as important, and if there's something else that you think is more important, we should get that on the table now. I think if council wants to fund stipends, I think we should fund stipends and honor that they're funding stipends and not say, hey, since you funded stipends, can we spend it somewhere else? I think if we're somewhere else, we'd like to spend that
we
money.
We say that now.
Yeah, exactly.
Question.
Yes, Commissioner Rios.
Mr. Casey, does the city have a area where money can be donated to the city for various? I don't know.
Yes, we have a number of nonprofits who raise money and donate it to the city.
So
the police department's very active.
Could, if we chose to do it, we could just.
Yes.
Turn the check over.
Yeah.
Well, it's not really our choice. We need to put it out there as a possibility for them
yeah,
to consider.
But as an individual, you could.
Well, my position is I would rather see enforcement go be done and its effect on historic pressure. I think that I would rather see a good enforcement program.
And you notice we are increasing enforcement in the recommended
yeah
budget, and then we're
yeah
even saying if you have some additional money, we could do more with enforcement.
Yeah.
And so if
yeah
the comment
that
comes,
kind of,
if
yeah
the comment that comes out of this commission is, you think we should prioritize that enforcement
well,
request?
The problem is, Mr. Casey, is that this commission is going to give you 8 different answers.
Maybe not.
I don't know.
Maybe 12.
Maybe 12. The other thing is that you know we've really only sort of wrapped our heads around this just today. So what other avenue do we have for getting our consensus to you? Because I think we need to arrive at a consensus, unless you guys feel like we can arrive at one today. I mean, we always arrive at consensus, usually.
Sure.
I'd welcome the stipend again. It would help me defer my current travel expenses.
Absolutely. Ms. Weiss.
Just a little bit more information on this topic. When we were at the single-family design board, earlier this week, that particular board really expressed appreciation for the stipend, right, and that they will probably be expressing to council an interest in having them fund it. The cost, or your portion of the stipend, just in case you're curious, it's approximately $12,000 for the HLC portion of the stipend.
So that in that 37, there's one for design, excuse me, there's one for single family design review, there's one for ABR, and there's one for HLC.
Correct.
Those are the three design reviews.
Of course,
and then,
just 1 second, let Mr. Casey, then Commissioner Reyes, then Commissioner Boucher.
Timing wise, our department presentation is May 2nd, and so that's coming up, but the decision on this issue probably wouldn't be until towards the end of May. And so there is time if you wanted to formulate kind of a stronger recommendation out of your board to, okay, to do so.
I think that would be the most useful to you and to us. So I'm going to probably ask for a discussion item at some point because we need to discuss it as a group. We can't do it behind closed doors, or we can't do it without. I have Commissioner Reyes, Commissioner Boucher, and Commissioner Drury.
One question, Mr. Casey. Are there other boards that are receiving stipends that are not currently like the public
airport commission or something like that?
Harbor because commission. They're mentioned in the charter.
Correct. I believe only the planning commission is the only other board that's receiving a stipend right now. I don't believe Harbor and the airport commission receive monetary stipends.
Or fire.
There was one that's 100 a meeting, I understood. But
I think that's like MTD or...
Yeah, I'm not sure of another city board or commission that's getting. I'll ask about that, but I'm not aware of that.
I appreciate it.
Commissioner Boucher, did you have something?
No, I
didn't. Commissioner Drury?
Yeah, if the stipend was voted by city council, we are free to accept or refuse it individually, right? I mean, or would we all have to accept and then disperse it as we wish? And in some cases, people drive a long ways to get to these meetings and...
You're going to kick in some towards Mr. LaVoice?
Well, I go, parties in Palm Springs. I mean, that's a long drive.
Yeah. No, it's a valid question. So, if they did give us a stipend, could we do with what we want?
You always donate money.
The way that the stipend has been budgeted before, it's a specific line item in the planning division budget, and we apply it consistently and fairly based on your attendance. Right. So it's really just a basic bookkeeping accounting decision once we have the fund.
Right.
I wouldn't want to have individual commissioners say, I didn't want it or I do want it. So in the event that it is funded, it's a line item and we carry it out.
It's mandatory that we take it and do with it. Okay. So Ms. Gantz, will you put on for the next HLC meeting, which is what, May 8th, a discussion item on what we'd like to send to council as a priority.
And if I may,
budget priority.
Do you have a sense of your board that we could report to council on May 2nd during our department budget that you're weighing stipends versus increased enforcement? Is that a fair...
Well, no. I mean, there's so many things that are going through my mind. Use the $12,000 for the HLC to hire a volunteer coordinator. And I'm not saying that we have that $12,000, and I'm not saying that we're even promised that $12,000. But if the commission doesn't want their stipend, or if a portion of the commission doesn't want it, use the money to fund something else. But that's just going through my mind. I haven't had a chance to really. So I personally don't feel that I can give you that recommendation right now, Mr. Casey.
Can you use a straw vote just to see where we're...
My point, though, is that there's so many other things. It's not just a black and white stipend or zoning enforcement or, you know what I'm saying?
Yes.
So, I mean, if the commission wants to take the straw vote, I will honor that. I don't see the commission jumping down my back. So
well, it stipend or I mean, do we even have the ability to direct funds that have been directed by the city council to a certain use, and I don't think we do.
But we can send our recommendation to council that we would like them to set that priority for that.
Correct. My personal opinion is that how we got the $30,000 for the Historic Resources Work Program is that it was an iterative process that we kind of laid out, and then the timing was right to insert it into the budget, and I think we're going to be successful. Mm-hmm. I have a high degree of confidence that we're going to be successful on that $30,000.
You're on tape.
Exactly. No, I am. Exactly. You know, it's in the recommended budget. Council's already expressed support.
Yeah. Okay.
I think that one's going to be very successful.
I don't feel that we can give you a straw vote today.
Let me just finish, though, to Mr. Lavoie's point, is that I'll just be a little hesitant of just using a brainstorming session at your next meeting of what idea do you want to try to get funded. I just don't know, coming in so late in the process with a new concept is going to be successful. That's just my
That's fair, and I would ask that staff give us some clear direction on what we can and cannot discuss, or what we should and should not discuss. I think
maybe it's a discussion for next year. For next year's budget.
And I think that might be helpful exactly, is kind of identifying your priorities going forward if funding becomes available, about where the real need is. I think coming in at the last second.
The commission is going to change next year, though.
Yeah.
So
it always does.
Yeah.
Okay. Well, I think we have enough to
show. One other comment, not on the stipend.
Yes. Go ahead.
I recently had the experience of coming across a 12-year-old ZIR that I had to abate, and I didn't know half the stuff they were talking about, where it existed on this house. Next year's budget, as you look at the charge for ZIR, that you also include an enforcement prior to close of escrow fee in there, so that you have the funds to send someone out and make sure that these pieces of paper don't just get filed in a drawer. It was sort of embarrassing trying to explain to the client why he had to pay for something that
should have happened earlier.
That was removed before he bought the property.
Okay. Thank you, Ms. Weiss. Thank you, Mr. Casey.
Thank you.
Next item on the agenda is item number 2. It's an archaeology report for 34 East Mission Street. Ms. Gantz.
Mr. Chair, Dr. Glassell reviewed the report and concluded that the archaeological investigation supports the report's conclusions and recommendations that because the potential to encounter unknown but potentially significant subsurface prehistoric remains is considered very unlikely, project impacts on prehistoric resources are less than significant. However, the standard condition regarding discovery of unanticipated archaeological resources applies to the project and shall be reproduced on plans prior to final design review approval.
Okay. Do we have any public comment? Seeing none, I'll close public comment and discussion or questions from the commission. Anyone?
No.
Okay.
Motion to accept the report.
Second.
I have a motion by Lavoie, a second by Boucher. Under discussion, anyone? All in favor?
Aye. Aye.
Opposed? Abstained? Motion carries. Next item on the agenda is a concept review of 34 East Mission Street. This is comments only. The project requires environmental assessment, compatibility criteria analysis, and staff hearing officer review. Would you like these back?
I've got a copy. I'll take them here.
Okay.
They're extras, so.
Okay.
I'll take that one.
Okay, if you'd please state your name for the record, give us a brief presentation, and be sure that your microphones are on and that you keep your mouth close to the microphones. And use the pointer if you have to lean in.
Hi, good afternoon.
Your microphone's not on.
Not on.
There you go.
Good afternoon. Jarrett Gorin from Vanguard Planning. I'm the agent. I'm representing Catherine Compeer. She's the property owner here. And I have with me Bob Taylor, who is the contractor that's doing all the restoration work out here on 34 East Mission. And we were here before your board back in October, I think it was, last year, with the historic resources report for this.
Right.
And at that time, we included all of the changes to this house, and we also included the structure that we're here for design review today. So that's already been the subject of a report which your board accepted. So our project involves demolition of the existing three-car garage that's back here. There's sort of a nondescript flat roof, three roll-up door garage that's built right around here.
Just to give everybody orientation, this is Anacapa Street and this is East Mission. Go ahead.
Okay, so that garage is built pretty much on a zero setback and has three doors which face directly towards the street. And granted, it's still pretty far back into the property and it's not readily visible from any public streets. But the project that we have, that we're proposing, is to demolish that garage and to build back a new garage, which is further to the interior of the property. We're going to rotate the orientation 90 degrees so that there are no garage doors visible down the street. And the actual garage area of the new garage is slightly less than the existing garage, although it still exceeds the standard 500 feet, which is why we're asking for a modification. And then on top of that garage area, we'd have a small accessory office space and a toilet and sink, but no bathing facilities. And if we turn and look at the elevations, it's basically been designed to match the architecture of the residence. So we have sort of an industrial building out there right now that serves as a garage, and this would be the new structure. And
it's page 8. Page 8.
So basically, we've got a craftsman type structure, wood shingle siding to match the siding of the house, three single garage bay doors facing towards the driveway. I'm trying to figure out which one of these two elevations. I guess one of these elevations faces Anacapa Street, although you wouldn't really see it from Anacapa Street because it's behind. It's entirely behind the existing residence, which is quite a bit taller than it is. So it's a two-story structure, but it's entirely into the interior of the lot, and it's screened on all four sides by either the existing structure or some existing hedges. But this is what it looks like if you could see it from, I guess, inside the lot. It would look like this.
Oh, that's the main residence.
And then we also have a gate that we're adding at the end of the driveway, just your standard two-part gate rather than a single swinging leaf. We have two leaves. And this and the other thing are what triggered the archaeology study, since the footings will go beyond 18 inches. But that's pretty much the project.
Okay. I will open public comment. Ms. Gantz, do I need to acknowledge the letter from Ms. Westbury?
Yes. Okay.
I am acknowledging a written letter from Paula Westbury in opposition to this project. See no other public comment. I'll close public comment and move to questions from the commission. Let's start with Commissioner Schallenberger. Any questions?
I'm going to defer.
Okay. Commissioner, what's your name?
Winnick.
Sorry.
I have one question. It's basically bring over the photographs. I was wondering if maybe you could point out on the photograph where this additions happening from the street photos, just so I can quite, I understand it's at the back of the property.
Yeah, it was.
I'm just wondering if I were to sketch it in, which one of these photographs would it take place on?
It was a challenge. The frontages are really long, and so I had to break them in half. I guess the best, let's start with looking at the Mission Street frontages.
Okay.
And the one that doesn't show the house.
That would be this one.
Yeah, so the house is sort of up here. This garage, it would be...
Hold on 1 second. I'm sorry. Let me just fold this over.
Oh, that's a good idea.
A better match line here. Somewhere in there. Yeah, sort of like
that. Okay, so, it would be somewhere in this area if you could see it.
Mm-hmm. On Mission.
Okay, right. Great. That's what I was trying to find out. Thank
okay,
you.
And then did you want Anacapa too?
Well, sure. Why not?
Okay, I don't think this one's quite matched. But
it doesn't go 100%, but
well,
this
car was white, and this photo, this car is red.
There's a little space between those two.
Okay.
From the Anacapa elevation, it's directly behind the house. So yeah, you couldn't see it from Anacapa.
That possibly maybe there.
If it was tall enough, I think it would have to be three or four stories to be able to see that.
Well, this portion is one story.
Yeah. Right.
It is, but it's, again, line of sight from even across the street here. If you were to extend that,
so far
extrapolate
back.
It out, this would have to be three or four stories to see.
Thank you. I'll take those back unless you want to keep them.
Nope, I'm going to give them to you. There you go.
Thanks. Thank you.
Could you roll back?
That was my question.
Yeah.
Garage elevation and then the house elevation.
Okay, garage elevation, existing residential, residence elevation.
Try the page 8 again, it would be garage elevation, I think.
Okay, so we're on page 5. Page 5 and page 4, 5, and 8.
We've got 8 here, so 4.
This is the frontage on Mission.
Correct.
This is the frontage State Street. Sorry.
Yeah. This would actually be the frontage exactly opposite Mission.
Yeah, State Street. Oh, I beg your pardon. Then Pedregosa.
What page are we on?
And then this would be State.
Correct.
State.
That's the elevation you could see from this garage if you were standing in this garage or the backyard of the house.
Okay. This is the existing house.
Yeah, it's the existing house. Yeah.
This is from Anna Kappa. You've got your gate here.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. Questions, Commissioner Arias? Any questions? Deferring? Okay. Commissioner Lavoie?
No.
Sharp? No. Commissioner Boucher? Any questions? Commissioner Drury? Any questions?
Yeah, south elevation that faces
south.
South. but down the block, along Anacapa Street toward Pedregosa.
Yes.
Yeah. Okay.
Yeah.
Like I drive by this house every day, you know, but it's well hidden. It's hard to, yeah.
It is.
Thank you,
Commissioner Schellenberger. Did you formulate any questions?
No questions?
Okay, then we'll go to comments. Commissioner Schellenberger, did you have any comments?
Generally positive comments.
I did open the door closed to have a comment.
That'd be fine.
All right,
that'd be fine.
Can I have order, please? Can I have order? There's too many discussions going on. I opened public comment and I closed public comment.
Right, but it was before the applicant presentation.
It was after the applicant presentation. I will honor your request to speak, but let me get through this portion of the meeting, please. Okay? Thank you. Commissioner Schellenberger, could you please repeat your comments? Comment.
This is, okay. Generally positive comments. I think it's compatible. I don't see any design guideline flaws. I think the applicant's presenting a good project.
Okay, thank you. Commissioner Winnick?
Nothing else to add.
Okay. Commissioner Arias?
I agree that the design is appropriate, and I think the gate is appropriate, and all. I have not seen the floor plan for the second upstairs. I would like to look at the floor plan.
Okay, if we could look at that floor plan and run through it real quickly for
sure.
The commissioners.
Image.
Second floor plan.
Here it is. Accessory room.
What page? Oh.
Page 7.
Page 7. Oh, nice.
Okay, so, and would you like me to run through it, or
yes,
you just?
I appreciate you.
So, what we've done here is we have three garage bays on the ground floor. We staggered one in so that they weren't all in a single plane. And then we've got just a man door out the back. And then we have an exterior staircase up to the second floor. And that's just a single large room for an office with a little powder room. And there's an exterior entrance into the powder room from this little deck that looks into the backyard, and a small closet for storing, I don't know, a printer, office supplies, whatever, and then a little door onto this deck. Yeah, I mean, that's really, if there's gardeners, it's a pretty large site, and this allows them to get up and into this bathroom from the exterior, and that's really it, and it's just a tight little roof plan.
Okay. Any other comments or questions from you? Commissioner Rias?
No, I assume you're going to go through building check.
Mm-hmm. Commissioner Lavoie, comments?
Well, the design is acceptable. In houses of this period, when a garage was built out back, it was quite a bit simpler than the main residence. The detailing is reduced. It's much more simpler a building. And this building, I'm afraid, is trying too hard to disguise the fact that it's a two-story building. There's too many ins and outs. There's too much stuff happening. There's too much detailing. And it makes it not fit with the existing house. Even how your second floor is sort of like wedding caked on top of it is like a very bad later addition to a garage rather than, if you look at the front of this house, how the second floor just sort of peeks out of quite a bit of roof slope, it doesn't look wedding caked. It looks like part of, and craftsman houses do that. They bury stuff in as opposed to stacking stuff on.
Well, I think that's why we push
actually comments. We're not in a discussion period right now. So
I don't think this is an appropriate design for this property based on the design of the existing house.
Okay, Commissioner Sharp.
I agree with what Mr. Lavoie has just stated. It seems overly complex. And mixing, and I realize the existing house mixes gables and hips, but this is going too far to try and do the same thing when I really feel that that this needs to be a hip rather than a gable, and making it all work so you have a gable there just seems to be stretching too far.
Okay. Commissioner Boucher?
I have nothing to add.
Commissioner Drury?
If I may ask a question of Commissioner Lavoie, how would you simplify?
The roof form, the building form, detailing. Less of everything.
Thank you.
Okay. Anyone else have any comments?
I guess I'll just make a comment and say I agree with Commissioner Sharp and Lavoie.
Okay, I will open public comment. Mr. DeForest.
Thank you very much, Kellum DeForest. This is a very, this is a rather important building, at least in my memory, because family friends live there. I did want to ask, what happens to the structure of merit status, eligible for structure of merit status, if this garage were built? Would that influence, would that negate that? Also, as I recall, and I don't know when the existing structure, because I don't recall the Historic Structures Report, when the existing structure garage that's there now went in. As I recall, years ago, there was a barn or a carriage house there in the back of the property. That design could be replicated, and that's what it should look like to go with this. Any addition, any garage, or should look like a carriage house. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. DeForest. Staff, Ms. Hernandez, do you have any response to Mr. Kellum DeForest?
I do. We did review the Historic Structures Report in 2012 and accepted it, and it did note that the garage would not impact the structure of merit eligibility status. And
did you find out what was there previous to the garage?
That I'd have to pull the reports, but I don't.
I can answer that.
Okay.
That's okay.
Okay.
Thank you, Mr. DeForest. I'll close public comment and I'll summarize the comments and look for a motion for continuance. The project is compatible with the compatibility analysis, but the building needs to be simplified and be subservient to the main house. It is overly complex. Simplify gable and hip mix. Ooh, I like that, gable and hip mix. Simplify the roof forms and details.
Mr. Chair?
Yes.
Would you add as appropriate to an accessory building in this period?
The project should reflect design as appropriate to an accessory building of this period. Anybody want to make that motion?
I'll make that motion for a two-week continuance.
Second.
Motion by LaVoie, second by Sharp. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Abstain? Motion carries.
Oh, yeah.
Okay. Simple.
Can I ask a question outside
Let me ask you a question. Okay. Do you understand the motion?
I understand the motion. My question, and I understand the simplification goal, and my question is, on the roof forms, is there a preference or direction as to all hips or all gables?
You come up with it.
Okay, great.
Thank you.
We'll leave some design to you.
Look at garages from the period.
Okay. I'm going to call a 5-minute recess. Thank you.
ready? Mr. Drury, Mr. Sharp,
Mr. Boucher. Okay, I'll reconvene. Next item on the agenda is item 4. It's a historic structures report for 1807 Santa Barbara Street. This is a review of a historic structures report prepared by Alexandra C. Cole, Preservation Planning Associates. The report found the building is not considered a historic structure. Okay, do we have any staff comments?
I reviewed the report and do support the conclusions of the report that the project in its current condition does not qualify as a historic resource.
Okay. Does the applicant have anything to add?
Mr. Chair, no, I don't. If you can look at that, I do have...
Put the microphone to your mouth, please. Thank you.
There. I don't have anything to add to that. If you wanted pictures of some of the other buildings that I said your HLC had earlier found eligible during this survey, I have pictures of that.
I think that will cloud the issue a bit. Okay, then I'll open public comment. One speaker slip from Mr. Callum DeForest. Okay, closing public comment, just kidding.
Ms. Cole, for the excellent report. I do have some, but I think you underestimated has nothing to do with whether the house is not a structure worthy of structure of merit or not. It is, and where is it now? It's the I've lost it. It was the
page 10.
We got it on? Yeah. It was the importance of the White family in Santa Barbara, and I don't, obviously, Ms. Cole wasn't here, she says on page 11, the house was built for Mrs. White for herself. And I guess it was in response, or maybe it was damaged in the 25 earthquake, and she did.
Mm-hmm.
So, is not associated with her three sons. So, in my growing up, it was very much associated with the three sons, and pointed out that it was the White House, and I don't know whether. Possibly Roderick lived in it while before his place further downtown, his studio down in El Cielo, whatever that section is called, was built. It was always pointed out to me as a house where the Whites had lived, and but maybe it was because I was a friend of Harvard White's eldest son. Bendy was his youngest son. So Harvard's oldest son, Stuart, and he was pointed it out. And what is wrong with what really ruined that house was the addition of the garage, and especially the carport. It looked fine before those additions.
It was a beautiful house.
And I think so. My query is, what does this do? What does not making it a historic resource do to the streetscape or the possibility of modifying or having someone tear it down and build something that was not, would greatly alter the streetscape, the important streetscape of Santa Barbara Street? Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. DeForest. Seeing no other public, I'll close public comment.
Mr. Chair?
Yes, Commissioner?
I would request that Ms. Hernandez respond about the streetscape question.
Ms. Hernandez, do you have anything to shed light on Mr. DeForest's question?
If the building and property is not designated a historic resource or a potential historic resource, yes, it can be torn down. I know that all the review boards do look at compatibility issues, but there's nothing specifically protecting the property in a historic sense.
And my understanding, my understanding of the report is that it's not found significant because of its alterations and not meeting considerable number of criteria.
Correct. So we won't be able to protect it. It will be out of the Historic Landmark Commission's review. It will go back to the ABR or SCFD, Single Family Design Review.
Okay. Commissioners have any questions?
Yes, I do.
Yes, Commissioner Schallenberger?
The south elevation with the raised...
Are you looking at a photo?
Oh, page 22.
Thank you.
The elevated sill there of the French patio doors. Was the intent for there to, or was there at one time a patio or some type of deck off of that?
I think it shows up even better on page 21.
22.
Yeah, either.
Yeah.
I'm just curious.
Do you have the original drawings again? Because I know... Commissioner Schallenberger, the part on the left was an open porch. And
right
this,
here.
Yes, oh, at the left, yes, and that was enclosed. But this always was a mystery to me. It looks as though it needed to have some sort of a balcony or a deck.
Just watch that first step.
But no, yeah, right. So, but I don't know.
A Juliet balcony would solve the problem.
They may still be at my desk.
Oh,
would you want to review? We have the archive.
I think it was just a curious question.
Just if in your historical research, if that had occurred, or
if you would please get
those. Yeah, I'll grab them.
Okay, Commissioner Winnick, any questions?
Yeah, I guess I'd like to follow up on Mr. DeForest's query. Just what I'm hearing is sort of, could this project go forward and still be a designated as a structure of merit? I think is sort of the question is, like, it's not exactly what he said, but it's sort of what I'm kind of formulating as a question as a result of that, is it doesn't seem to me that the project that's proposed is antipathetic with it being designated as a historic structure, in which case it would, if it could still be designated as a historic structure and still go ahead with the proposed development, I guess, then there's sort of a benefit that this building, with its context in the neighborhood, would fall into maintaining the historic nature of the neighborhood. I guess it's sort of the question I'm wondering. So I guess I'll ask a question. Probably that's the question I'm not supposed to be asking, but I guess the question I want to ask is, what about this structure is so damaged that it couldn't be considered a historic structure of merit? In other words, obviously knowing that a carport would be removed or a porte cochere that was added or something like that would be removed, how would that prohibit it? Like, what's keeping this from being a structure of merit or a potential structure of merit?
Is that a question?
Yeah, I know. I'm sorry. I'm having a hard time. Ms. Cole, sorry.
Thank you. It's one of those things that if there was one change, then all right, you can make the finding that there's just one change. But from my point of view, what I outlined on page 11,
right,
there were so many changes that all of a sudden it becomes cumulative that it is not a good representative anymore. And I think as it was mentioned, it was the carport extension mm-hmm. primarily and the porte cochere, because those are both on the facade. But from my point of view, it was also those windows up on the second floor of the facade that, again, took away the ratio of wall space to openings. Mm-hmm. And so because of those cumulative alterations, now you could, one could, for the sake of argument, say, well, all right, remove all those. Mm-hmm. Well, then that would be a project. And then you'd come back and say, you know, the applicant has decided to remove all those additions. Then you would say, aha, now it's been returned to its sufficient level of integrity mm-hmm. that then you could say, yes, it is.
Okay, I think that answers your question, yes?
Yeah.
Okay.
Thank you.
Commissioner Arias, any questions?
Well, my only concern is that it is part of a neighborhood that I see, and I know that, oh, I realize there are things that have been done that are not according to Hoyle, but it is part of the neighborhood, and I would hate to see it demolished and something going there that was totally out of sync. I mean, there is some harmony between that and the other buildings. I would hope that nobody would do it, but we have all sorts of people.
Well, the proposal, the project we're reviewing today is the historic structures report. So,
I know what it is.
Yeah. So
I've read it.
Thank you. Commissioner, what's your name, LaVoy?
It's been a long time.
You get where she's hit me. I have a similar question. Being a structure of merit identifies a building that has some characteristics, and as your report in great detail and exhaustively identifies those elements that don't contribute to that rating. And it would be really lovely if particularly the carport, or the porte cochere, not the carport, but the porte cochere really needs to go away. But that's not the proposal today. But we have accepted buildings as being historic and identified those non-contributing elements and still kept the designation, at least leaving it on the potential list, which would make me very happy. Because when I know this house from walking the neighborhood, and it always looked historic except for that porte cochere from the street. I mean, even the garage addition looks like something that might have been done in the period. And in structures of merit, we do allow additions and changes and growth and things to happen as long as they're compatible with the original style. And to let the architect breathe a little bit easier, everything he's proposing is compatible with a structure of merit.
Such a coin.
So I do have an issue with just sort of wiping this off the potential list based on some unfortunate additions. Because by doing so, we're sort of taking off the ability for this commission to restore this house if a future applicant would like to do that.
There's those windows.
Question. You're familiar, very familiar with that process of keeping a building as a structure of merit. You have identified, reasons for not. Could you rewrite the report to leave it on at least the potential list?
Commissioner LaVoy, excuse me.
It is not on the potentials list currently.
To allow
it has not been added.
It's not been added. On
okay.
The
so that we would, in the next time that's done, add it to the potential list.
You're asking me, Commissioner.
Yes,
LaVoy.
Could you make that recommendation?
I could not, or I would have made it in the report. I just felt that, as I said, because of the numbers of changes, that I could not, in good conscience, state it was still remaining as a structure of merit. And actually, we're not to talk about the proposed project, but the proposed project maintains the building.
Right.
It's not a demolition.
Yes. Thank you.
Okay. Commissioner Sharp, any questions?
No question.
Commissioner Boucher?
No.
Commissioner Drury?
Yes.
question?
I'm looking at the drawing on the screen, and I noticed that those upright pillars around the garage doors are not reflected in how it was eventually built.
Or maybe it's modified.
There's these rather wide, unattractive, angled supports for the...
Well, it was altered in that this portion here was originally this garage door.
I know.
Okay.
So that was taken away. And so seeing this as well, and seeing the proportion of the original as opposed to what is there now, was, again, part of my analysis.
I understand that, yeah. Thank you.
Did we find out what was around that other side? Doors
you're
that
right.
opened
They all they
nothing.
Went down.
Well,
they
he went may down have just
to
put the
the sill.
Yeah, he may have gotten there.
So they were built that way.
Huh. All right.
Even the basement had an outdoor stairway, which I thought was more of a contemporary, but it appears that that's exactly how it was built.
Mm.
I had a question for you, Ms. Cole. Is the Regina Montgomery that you mentioned in the report the wife of a Mayor Norris Montgomery? Norris Montgomery served as mayor of Santa Barbara from, I think, 49 to 51, something like that. Did you run across in your research that's the same Regina?
I did not, but that does not mean it isn't. It must be the same Regina.
Well, there's... Yes. There's
Spinoza Mary just came up as her name.
Right.
Yes.
Yeah, there's a question in my mind, because I grew up across the street from this house, that Regina was related to a previous mayor of Santa Barbara. And in Criterion C, it's noted that this house is not identified with a person or persons who significantly contribute to the culture and development of the city, the state, or the nation. Whether or not Norris Montgomery was a good mayor or not, I don't know.
That would really...
He was pretty blah.
Was he?
Oh,
well, I think Hal knows. And Hal took some photos of... Oh. Your husband took some photos of Norris.
Of course, he's taken a photo of everybody.
The Suti family lived across the street also.
Oh, there
were
those.
Yeah. Well, that makes it less important. But in any case... So I would like to see Criterion C maybe expanded upon, because if, in fact, that is the same person who lived in the house, then I would think that should be noted in the report. But
you know, I don't mind noting it. However,
doesn't make it
in order to determine how significant was his contribution.
Yeah.
To was he, if he'd been mayor for 25 years, if X, Y, and Z things had happened that affected the way the city worked, or mm-hmm. the way certain buildings were built, or urban planning, any of those things, that to me would then be something that would be noteworthy.
Okay. Any other comments?
Well, actually, yes.
It's just interesting, as I've been listening to this, we're going to vote shortly on whether to accept or amend or reject the report. But I don't think that the proposed project would have any impact one way or the other. I think the appears that the proposed project would be compatible either way, if it were a potential structure or not. So it's an interesting debate we're having, but I think your project is going to likely go forward without impact.
Right. Yeah, and again, we're here to evaluate the report and whether or not we agree with the report. The project that is being proposed is certainly helpful in evaluating this, but
well,
it's not
I only bring it up because you know, potentially if there was anything you got out of this discussion that would have affected your design, and I'm not hearing that there is anything. So.
Yes, I've spoken with the client about removing the portico share because there are just certain things that I see that aren't right with the house, and. At this point in time, they're reluctant to do so. I'm still chatting with them about it. But I don't think we can count on them restoring the house at this point in time. Maybe they might change their minds, but I have mentioned it to them.
Yeah, and we have to evaluate it based on today's
situation.
Yeah. So there's no proposal before us for
removal of the carport or the portico chair. Mm-hmm. Mr. Winnick, comments?
Oh, comments. Well, I guess my comment is still in line with my question. It's just that I guess for me, I like to see the, you know, it's a building that's compatible with the neighborhood as it is currently. And I think that's part of its historic character. So I have a hard time voting to accept the report, which says that it has no historic significance, because it could be replaced at a later date as a result, even though I know our current applicant is looking like they're lovingly intending to restore the house and do a wonderful project. There could be somebody at a later date, and that's more what I'm concerned about.
Okay.
That doesn't honor the house.
Commissioner Rios?
I agree with him.
Okay. Commissioner Lavoie?
Very briefly, I agree with him. Yeah. It's
okay. Commissioner Sharp?
I agree.
You finished, I'm sorry. You finished?
Yeah.
Okay. Commissioner Sharp?
I agree.
Commissioner Boucher?
I
Commissioner Gerrari?
I don't.
You don't? Fine. So, what's the pleasure of the commission? Somebody want to make a motion?
Can I ask?
Or,
I think we need to just, the only thing is we have to brace the accepting the report on the criteria in front of us. And if there's a criteria for that you're finding that it's meeting that has not been analyzed, we need to have her go back and reevaluate a criteria.
Well, I think one of those criteria
I have a question.
I'm sorry, go ahead.
Nicole, can we add a house to the potential list accepting this report stating that it doesn't qualify anymore?
We would have to first notice them to be that they're going to be added to the potential list, which is a 60-day noticing.
Okay.
And otherwise, unless they waive the noticing and request.
But if we have a report that states it doesn't qualify, can we override that report?
If we don't accept the report, then
you would have a hard time defending why it would go on the potential list.
And we can accept the report and disagree with the findings?
Yes.
No.
Yeah, you've done that before.
Done that before.
Yes, you have. No, they've done it before, and they've
got wrong.
Slap.
It stung for days.
You do need to accept the report or reject the find. That's the point of the report, is okay. That we all.
The fact that Ms. Gantz was absent, and she probably texted me.
You might want to just take a minute and review the criteria. Is there a criteria that this is falling under? That's where we would need to find a case and be specific about where we think this, in its current condition, it's hard to.
I would also like Commissioner Murray's input, and since she's absent, we are not getting that. And that's a very important part of this commission, of this commission, is our historian's input.
I agree.
Is this something that needs to happen today? Is the approval or disapproval of this report something that needs to happen today in your time frame?
I think so, yeah. We're trying to get the building department to, and also they're on a time crunch to do it for the summer. So I would say we would appreciate a decision.
Can I propose something?
Yes.
Just bring up a topic. So I'm thinking the one that speaks to me in terms of the criterion that I was speaking about would be criterion I.
Page 12. Criterion I, page 12.
It says, although this house has been a familiar and established feature of the neighborhood because of its alteration, it does not retain a single physical characteristic that would make it significant to the streetscape. It is not considered eligible underneath this criterion. Perhaps that's the one that I think I was hearing, and it's one that I was speaking to. So perhaps that's the criteria that could be reevaluated.
I think also criterion C, the building is not identified with the person or persons who significantly contribute. That needs a little more study, I think.
Well, yeah, that would be just the mayor.
Well, yeah, but
suiting and
we don't know. We don't know what he did or didn't do. So,
Mr. Chair,
how can we say that criterion C?
About the white.
It makes it ineligible.
Mr. Chair.
Yes, Commissioner Lavoie.
I'd like to make a motion to reject the report on the basis of disagreeing with criterion I. Disagreeing with the findings, and making the comment that while the building has been altered and the alterations are accurately described in the report, we do not believe that it denies the building its significance.
Do we have a second?
Second.
Second by Boucher.
Question.
Under discussion, Commissioner Rios.
Would the maker of the motion include the statement that it's significant to the streetscape?
Yes.
And also, would the maker of the motion consider including criteria C, which would be expanding on the mayor issue that Mr. Suiting has mentioned?
Are you sure it's the same mayor?
Yeah. Yes, please.
So did you get that? Ms. Feliciano?
Under discussion.
Okay, we have a motion, and just want to make sure that the motion is understood or recorded correctly.
Okay, so you're disagreeing with the findings and criteria C and I? Is that what I heard?
Based on criteria C and I.
C and I. Okay, with the comment findings. That while the building has been altered and the alterations are accurately described in the report, you do not believe that it denies the building its significance. Now, I'm not really sure what to put in significant to the streetscape.
Significant to the streetscape and its original design.
Okay, thank you.
Okay, under discussion, yes. Commissioner Murray, or Commissioner Drury.
I was just going to add about criterion I, although I disagree I would not vote to reject the report. The most significant architectural, which is the facade on Santa Barbara Street, has been there for almost 50 years. And I personally can't stand the building when I drive by. I try to avert my eyes because it's an eyesore for me because of what was there before. I do remember that. Anyway, I don't know that, but that's what you're saying in this motion.
That there's enough left that keeps its significance.
Thank you.
And all of the alterations which were identified could be changed to make it more compatible and keep the building, should a future owner or this present owner come to that conclusion.
Thank you.
Can I also add that a 2-week continuance, should the preparer of the report wish to reevaluate her conclusions?
I would say that you'd probably have to get somebody else to do this part because I can't agree.
Okay.
So you might have to find someone else to address these points.
So that would be
indefinite continuance.
Okay. Under discussion, Commissioner Schallenberger.
I want to understand for myself what would be the downside to the conclusions and the findings that it is significant. I mean, what if this report said that it was? What would be the downside to property owner or the city or any interested party?
Are you saying what does this report as it stands today? What would be the downside of
if it were changed and Ms. Cole changed her findings, which I understand you said you're not going to, but. I guess I'm struggling because I'm about to vote whether to reject a report from a qualified historian, and the city historian has concurred with the conclusions, and so I'm not sure personally how I'm going to vote way, but I guess if it just said it was significant.
Yeah. Let me ask you a question. Does the house retain a singular physical characteristic that would make it significant to the streetscape? Retain from its original. You've seen drawings of its original.
Right. Yeah, no, I'll consider that when I vote.
Okay. Sure.
Thanks.
Does that help more or less?
I'd like to see the report change, but.
Mr. Chair?
Okay. Yes, Commissioner Lavoie.
If we accept the report, then we don't review it anymore.
Yeah, I understand.
Anything.
No, that's the downside to accepting it. I'm saying what's
really
the downside to change?
A bummer.
That's a question from the skull.
I can just speak for when I reviewed the report twice, I also struggled with it because it does retain some original features, but trying to keep in the framework of what it is now and not what it could be if it were restored, but what it is now, which is how the National Register has reviewed most of their properties when they come in. And that's sort of the integrity and threshold we hold ourselves to as preservationists.
Yeah, I mean, there are clear guidelines from the Secretary of the Interior and, you know, standards. And, of course, standards are left up to interpretation, but,
correct.
You know, I personally feel that the house does not retain that characteristic of which it had in, or that character of which it had it originally. And so, therefore, the report is correct for this time. And I don't think that we should, this is a conundrum, because if we accept the report, then we don't necessarily have a chance to put it on the potential list, ever. And it is potential, but does it retain that singular characteristic that it had in the beginning? When it was built in, what was it, 1910, 1908?
26.
26, okay. Yeah, you're right, 26. That's the question in my mind. And I defer to the historian that prepared the report. Again, I think it is unfortunate that we don't have our commission's historian here to help guide us. I mean, we have the applicant and we have our urban historian, but we don't have one other key person. And if it were my preference, I would rather continue this 2 weeks to have Ms. Murray review it and weigh in on it than I would to reject the report. So I don't think I would vote for rejecting the report.
Is there a possibility of making that motion?
Well,
a motion's been made.
And the applicant has stated that they want a motion today. So, I'm going to end the discussion, and I'm going to call for a vote. All in favor of the motion, which is an indefinite continuance to alter the report or to change the report, say aye.
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 So we have Winnick, Arias, Lavoie. Yeah. Okay. Opposed?
Aye.
We have Drury.
Passes.
Boucher, Suiting, and Schallenberger.
So that's
abstain?
Four. Sharp abstains.
Sharp abstains on what basis?
My architectural partner at the time designed the porte-cochere.
he's the one.
The truth comes out.
Boy, it took all that to find that out.
Yeah, which one?
Okay, so it's 4-3. It's 4-3?
I think there's only three in favor.
I'm sorry.
I think it failed.
It failed. Motion
could you failed. Count up again? I'm
yeah, it was three in favor of the motion and four against the motion.
Okay, so
motion failed.
Motion failed. Do we have a substitute motion?
Yes.
Commissioner Schallenberger.
2 week continuance till Commissioner Murray is here.
I second that motion.
What was it? A 2 week continuance for Commissioner Murray to review the report. All in favor?
Aye.
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 Opposed? Abstain? Motion carries.
Thank you.
That's the best thing, I think, for this project, for this report. Okay.
Very good.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thanks.
There we go.
Yes, we're moving forward.
moving forward.
Slowly. Mr. Chair,
yes?
Will you contact Commissioner Murray and make sure
I will
she
absolutely contact
reviews
Commissioner.
The tapes sure. And hears all the discussion?
I will do that.
Thank you.
Are we done?
No. Next item on the agenda is item number 5. This is a concept review of 900 Channel Drive. The item was scheduled for 2:55 p.m. It is now 30 minutes past. Commissioner,
Mr. Chair.
Ms. Gantz.
And I'll wait until everybody's.
Okay. Right. Can everybody settle down? And Ms. Gantz, make an announcement, please.
So this item on the agenda is for you to make the compatibility criteria analysis only. It was missed at the last review.
Okay.
And what I want to do is read the minutes from the last review so that you are refreshed. It was on October 24th. Drury, Murray, and Schellenberger were absent. The motion was continued indefinitely with following comments to the Planning Commission. The Commission would like to make it clear to the Planning Commission that any future company that wishes to co-locate at the site shall present the proposal to the HLC for review. In the future, this pole shall be removed if other installations supersede this pole's equipment. The applicant has pursued a design in its simplicity to minimize the impacts of the installation. The monopole is the least intrusive. A faux tree or artificial vines are not acceptable. Graffiti-proof the wall to the extent possible. A vine on the wall may be the best graffiti solution, which would require a temporary water tank. The applicant shall implement a maintenance program for graffiti removal during vine establishment. All antenna need to be enclosed within the pole. Increase the height of the wall to screen the equipment enclosed. Eliminate the fenestration on the wall. And the color of the pole and wall will require HLC review. And that was motion by Lavoy, second by Sharp, 6-0 was the vote. So I just need for the HLC to make the compatibility criteria analysis, which is on the wall behind me.
Since I made the motion, I guess I should do it, huh? Do I need to cite which one?
You could just
by number
you
one.
Just say,
do you have this?
Two. Three for sure. And four in particular.
I'm sorry?
Four in particular.
What's
sensitivity to adjacent landmarks and historic resources.
Do you find that the project is
yes.
in compliance with the with
yes,
this?
Yes, I do.
Okay, great. You made the motion.
There's
Schellenberger,
a second.
Second.
All in favor of the motion, say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Aye. Aye. Opposed? Motion carries.
Thank you.
No, and then it was only to the motion.
Don't we get to keep these?
Next item is number 5, 900 Channel Drive. Oh.
The number 6.
Exactly.
Well, we have to leave.
Now?
Howdy.
Yeah.
Okay,
smoking.
Okay, and we do. Okay.
Excuse me, Chair Sharp?
Mr.
Or is
Sharp?
It Chair Lavoy?
Are you stepping down?
I have no choice.
That's right. I guess I'm doing it.
I have no choice.
Kelly Broadison, assistant planner to the project. And I just wanted to mention that this project was continued at the last HLC meeting, but the project can't go forward to Planning Commission until the compatibility analysis findings are addressed in the motion. So I just want to make sure that as you review this project today, you include that in your motion.
Okay. Is that all we need to do? No.
Chair Lavoy, there were some other comments that you had made, even though you did continue the project to Planning Commission, you asked for some changes, and the applicant has addressed those changes and also wants the compatibility analysis finding to be addressed.
Okay, thank you very much. Am I looking at the minutes?
Change the architect.
8:36 a.m. Give me a second.
I think I wasn't here. Yeah. But this is just concept, so I can get away with that.
Okay. So the comments that were made at the last meeting, the project is headed in the right direction. The commission appreciates the restoration of the existing structure. Study a more complete trellis over the garage door. Study adding divided lights to the two side windows above the garage on the north elevation. Restudy the roof form in the northeast elevation so that it is better integrated with the floor above. provide more detail of the east elevation, reduce the floor to floor and a north elevation above the garage. That passed unanimously. Gentlemen, if you could introduce yourself for the record, please.
Thank you. Keith Rivera, project architect.
Bob Cunningham, representing Arcadia Studio Landscape Architects.
Great, thank you. Could you tell us about what you've done?
Okay.
On sheet A1.1?
Yeah. So just to look at the site plan, the only real revision to the project after our first round of DART review was that transportation requested that garage number two be made 3 feet deeper.
Please.
So that's the only real configuration change to the basic layout. And then on the elevations, just to go through the commission's comments, we did enlarge the trellis over the garage door, as was suggested, and added the divided lights at the upper floor. On the roof form here at the east, northeast corner, we did revise that, and just here's some thumbnails of that. Given that transportation made the garage a little deeper, that gave us an opportunity to have a little more substantial mass there so that we could make the upper floor feel like it was a little more integrated to the base. And then added a little more detail to the overhangs with some brackets and revisions to the windows, again, to relate it better to the upper floors. And then on the east elevation, again, because of the change in the garage form below, so that we have some variation to the eave line, and the roof line comes up a little higher, so there's kind of less negative space, which I think sort of addressed the concern there that it was perhaps blank. And then on the floor-to-floor at the garage, we basically have a minimum 8-foot garage plate height. And what we've done to kind of address the concern there is we added some additional bracket detailing at the window above to kind of minimize, again, the sort of negative blank space between the two openings to sort of reduce the apparent height that I think was the concern there with the commission. So those are the architectural refinements. We have a preliminary landscape plan at this point, so I'd like Bob to walk you through that so that you can make your compatibility findings there. And as a part of the review of the landscape plan, as a reminder, we have the private open space for the existing house in the front yard here, which technically, according to zoning ordinance, would require a 5-foot fence in front of it for privacy. And as you may or may not recall, this property has the existing kind of mature hedge along the street frontage, which we're continuing with our project. And so in your comments, we'd like you to address a waiver for the ordinance fence requirements as we're providing privacy with the hedge screen. So with that, I'll let Bob jump in.
With regard to the hedge, we're proposing to remove and replace. The hedge is not in terrible condition, but it could use some improvement. I believe you've probably got photographs of the site, or you've seen them. In any case, I think we'd be open to supplementing the existing hedge and not completely removing it. I'm not sure how the ordinance reads, whether you can take out a hedge that's existing non-conforming and replace it and then get back to the same height. If that's an issue, then we will be surgically removing damaged portions of the hedge and replacing them in like species mm-hmm. to what's existing. It's a Eugenia hedge now, predominantly. The essentially the landscaping of the site is you know, simply mostly drought tolerant ornamentals. The trees are all proposed to be fruit trees except for these three along the back side, and we'll be studying these further to make sure that we've got the appropriate species, but these trees are all proposed to be fruit trees. So we're not going to have tall trees. We could, we've discussed this in the office, and I think that this tree in the corner might be a taller tree if the commission feels that's appropriate. We do have three existing street trees on West Canto Perdido and one on Bath Street, and we're proposing to add another tree where I think this is the existing driveway being removed.
Correct.
In this location here. Small lawn for the private outdoor space for unit one, and the private outdoor space for unit two would be mostly paved.
Okay, I'll open public comment. Close public comment and bring it to the commission for questions. Commissioner Drury, any questions?
Madonna, thank you.
Ms. Gantz, do we have photographs?
Yes.
Commissioner Lavoie, any questions?
No questions.
Commissioner Arias?
Not at this time.
Commissioner Winnick?
None.
Commissioner Schellenberger?
No questions.
Question on the street tree that you would be providing. It says on the plan that it would be a Pyrus kawakamii, and I assume that that's the designated street tree for West Canto Perdido?
That's correct.
Was there any discussion on, say, a co-designation on that street to incorporate the podocarpus that's existing there? Mr. Cunningham, the podocarpus I'm referring to is this one here, which is this one there. Is there any openness on the Street Tree Advisory Committee to co-designate that based on?
I imagine there may be. Okay. We'd be happy to take it to them to ask, seek a co-designation with the podocarpus in mind.
Podocarpus being a much more substantial tree than the Pyrus kawakamii.
Yeah.
Pyrus kawakamii, there's no doubt about it. It's a beautiful tree. One of the redeeming qualities of this project and its massing really is the street trees. They help immensely in scale and shading and all of that. So I would look to really have that one as perhaps a podocarpus instead of a Pyrus kawakamii. Not going to hang my hat on it and say that I'm not going to approve the project based on that, but I'd like you to investigate the possibility of a podocarpus there. I think it would be a nice feature highlighting these Pyrus kawakamii instead of having Pyrus kawakamii, podocarpus, and the Pyrus kawakamii. That sort of, in my mind, dilutes the intent of a street tree.
I don't disagree. We'll be happy to take it to Street Tree Advisory Committee and make that request.
Okay. Otherwise, I don't have any other questions, so go to comments.
Actually, now I have a question.
Okay.
Just about the hedges, I just wanted to get that clarified again. You were asking for the hedge that's along Canto Perdido.
It would be this hedge here.
Correct. I'm just noticing on the plan.
City TV, zoom in, please.
That the plan says that the existing hedge trimmed to 42 inches height. Were you asking to do that, or were you asking to keep the hedges higher in lieu of it putting in a fence? I guess I may have gotten confused. So I just want to know what your intention was.
Well, we would prefer to keep it, at the existing height as much as possible, and that sort of depended on how much we had to replace.
All right, well, assuming that you can do that surgical replacement and you're able to maintain the hedge, would it be 42 or, in fact, even higher, and that's what is allowing you not to have to put in the 5-foot fence?
Well, we would like to keep it at the existing height, and that, and therefore screen the open space.
What is the existing height?
42.
Oh, it's a
50 and a half inches?
It's something like
it's
that.
It's higher than 42.
Yeah, it's higher than 42.
We'll call it 40. Sorry,
yes, Ms. Broderson.
Actually, what the applicant's really asking is a waiver in order to provide the private outdoor living space for unit one in the front yard. And it just so happens that there is this hedge there, and I think he's asking you to take that into your account in granting a waiver.
Well, I believe
there is a hedge.
I believe the waiver is for the requirement for a 5-foot fence to screen a private open space in a front yard. Right. So that's the request
to eliminate that.
A waiver of that fence requirement, given that we have some sort of hedge in front.
Right.
Well, it makes sense to me.
And I was just trying to make sure that I was understanding that. It's supportable to me, too. What I'm curious is by stating that it's a 42-inch height, would that then contradict that so that you wouldn't be able to remove the fence? That's really why I was asking. So
no,
should
it's
this
not 5 feet anymore.
Yeah, in other words, should we be crossing that out on the drawings or recommending that that gets crossed out?
I would prefer if you could recommend that it be crossed out, that you would support having it greater than 42 inches.
Because I'm just assuming that's what it needs to be in order to make it work.
The hedge itself predates the ordinance, so it is legal existing non-conforming at the height that it is in you know, with regard to privacy for that outdoor space, it ought to be left at a higher height.
Okay, thank you.
A question.
Commissioner Schallinger.
Is that right? You can have a 5-foot high fence, but not a 5-foot high hedge? I mean, in other words, you have to look at this ugly fence, but you don't get to look at a beautiful hedge.
I don't get it either. I don't get what's driving the 42-inch height of the hedge versus the 5-foot.
I always thought that had to do with vehicle within 10 feet of a driveway.
Well, that's what I was wondering. Was it more of a sight line?
Chair Suiting?
Yes, Ms. Broderson.
There's a fence and hedge height ordinance that's currently under moratorium right now that you can't have a fence, or hedge, wall, screen higher than 42 inches in the front yard along the front property line or along a driveway for 20 feet back. So we'll have to analyze that further in DART. I think the applicant is looking for a waiver so that he doesn't have to provide a 5-foot fence in the front.
But I thought you couldn't have a, you just said you couldn't have a 5-foot.
You have to apply for a modification if he gets a 5-foot fence, which is.
What's driving the 5-foot height?
It's in the ordinance. To provide private outdoor living space in the front, it needs to have a 5-foot high fence so that it's private from the street.
Okay.
And if you don't have the fence, you can ask to not have the fence as long as the design review board, either ABR or HLC, grants a waiver, just like sometimes you guys can grant.
Okay, so we really just need to throw the 42 inch out.
It has to be 42 inches unless they require
them. Okay.
Yeah.
Unless we require a modification. I don't know why I can't wrap my head around this one. All right, so any other questions?
No, thank you for answering.
comments?
Sure.
Go ahead.
We can support the hedge
at
its existing
height.
Okay. It's fine. I was in favor of the project to begin with, and I think the applicant has responded to the comments positively, and I can support the project going forward. I would also, you know, commend the mass, bulk, and scale and adding a little density here without getting too big. I think the applicant's done a good job of melding the two.
Commissioner Winnick?
I can support Commissioner Schallenberg's comments, and I, since I asked the question about the hedge, I also to state that I could support the hedge at its existing height in lieu of a 5-foot fence.
Commissioner Reyes?
I agree with the comments that have been made and support the hedge at the existing height.
Okay. Commissioner Lavoie?
I would agree and add recommend that the other commissioners grant the waiver for the removal of the 5-foot fence requirement and to compliment the architect on the renderings. They're really quite lovely.
Okay. Commissioner Drury?
I agree with the previous comments.
Okay. I'll add one more comment to that the applicant pursue a co-designation on West Cannon Perdido Street of Podocarpus with the evergreen pear. Or to be more correct, the fern pine with the evergreen pear. Okay, so I'll
I'll summarize. The commission supports the hedge height as is. The commission supports a waiver of the 5-foot fence requirement. The commission commends the mass bulk and scale and the renderings of the project.
Architectural style and renderings.
Okay. The commission commends the applicant in the architectural style and the architectural renderings.
Do we need to find
The commission would like the applicant to pursue co-designation of the West Cannon Perdido Street tree to be the firm pine and the evergreen pear. Okay, so did you have a...
Did we need to find a... for compatibility?
You can include that in the motion.
We will.
So,
yeah.
Okay. Do I have somebody that would like to make a motion?
So moved.
Okay.
Second.
So moved by Schallenberger, second by Drury, making the compatibility findings?
Yes.
All in favor?
And indefinitely continued.
Oh, I'm sorry. Indefinitely continued.
Staff hearing officer, right?
Oh, yeah. Indefinite continuance. Thank you. All in favor?
Aye. Aye.
Opposed? Abstain. Motion carries.
Thank you.
Thanks.
That would have been a nice length of driveway. Otherwise, it's going to be a little bit sore. Yeah.
Well, it just it highlights these even more. I think.
Thanks again.
Got three of them.
Really?
Jeff would kill you if I finished it
again. That's pretty good news.
See you in a couple weeks.
Really?
Oh, no, you'll get a hold of me about...
There's someone else making that. So 5 times a day.
Yeah, I know.
Okay. You all have my email address.
Feel better?
Yeah.
Quick folder.
Yeah. I know that's true. I know it's true.
I'm not such a, it's just that they're not crinkly. I just printed out.
Oh, is it the same thing?
Yeah, it's the same thing.
Just when we thought it was safe.
Okay.
Okay, the next item on the agenda is item number 7. This is a concept review continued from August 29th, 1000 Chapala Street. This is a proposal to install a 200-square-foot prefabricated bike station module in city parking lot number 3 near the current MTD bus station. This project is being funded by a Measure A grant. If you please introduce yourselves for the record and give us a brief presentation and help us with M&Ms.
Yay. Jessica Grant, Public Works Department. With me today is Victor Garza, Parking Superintendent. Tim O'Brien, Architect.
Welcome.
Behind us, we have Todd Boulanger from Bike Station. Welcome. And then we have Laura Yanez. She's the newest addition to the Streets Engineering Design Team.
Well, welcome all the way around.
Okay. Yes.
Let me summarize the motion from the last meeting, which was August 29th. And that was continued indefinitely with comments. A flat roof may be the most appropriate roof type. There should be a building code minimum gap between the bottom of the stucco and the top of the paving surface. Study adding landscape, perhaps a vine to soften the building. The windows should be recessed a minimum of 4 inches. Keep the building simple in its form and detailing. Study the lighting that may be proposed.
Okay.
Commissioner Schallenberger has left. Okay.
All right. So last time you saw the bike station module project was back in August. This was the sheet that was presented at that time. I'm only using it for purposes of where we're talking about in terms of location. So the bike station module, which would provide secure bicycle parking, would be located at city parking lot number 3. And the cross streets are Chapala and then Figueroa. Right here is the MTD MTD Transit Center. And so the location of the bike station module that we had proposed would be right in behind the transit center, approximately 125 feet away from the right-of-way. So this picture here is if you're standing on the sidewalk here. And would be located, the module would be located back in this direction here. With that, I'm going to turn it over to the architect so he can, since that time, we now have an architect and bike station on contract, and he'll bring us through the design.
Good afternoon.
Good afternoon.
Having another sunny day in Santa Barbara.
Yeah, really. Yeah. You wouldn't mind using the pointer that Jessica has.
Oh, wrong one. There you go. Thank
you.
Excellent. As she had pointed out, we have the module in this location. We are approximately 125 feet set back. In this case, the entry would take place on the 10-foot side. It's roughly 200 square foot module. This is the existing landscape area, and this would create a pedestrian thoroughfare suitable for ADA access still on that parking lot side. Per the recommendations of the commission, we have sought to create what we hope would be something deemed appropriate within the overall context of Santa Barbara's architecture. Have gone to a flat roof structured building with some minor corner parapet details. In this case, true divided light and inset windows. In this case, three on each of the long elevations, villa style door. On the secured entry side, and on the back panel, which you'll see here, we have to accommodate for our passive cooling. We have a louvered opening, also inset and secured, our utility hookups, and also then the scupper and drainage from the roof. As we look at that elevation by elevation, and we've got a fairly, maybe you look down here, the lower point of the parapet, our roof structure, is actually at 10 feet. You have a very small parapet segment here. And again, these architectural expressions on this side, on each of the four corners, excuse me. We have a beveled sill. It is a hard coat stucco building utilizing both the Arizona white and stone beige, common to the parking structures within the town. We are also looking at then the accessory pieces such as the windows and whatnot in a burnt sienna tone, subject to manufacturer or a specific request of the commission. This, as we come back around on this, also on the back side, again, there were some questions. We are passively heated. Heated and cooled, so to allow that airflow, again, we've got a secure louver on the elevation, which we're sort of deeming our rear elevation, which tucks into that existing landscape area. Again, as we look into the interior, we've got our secure bike storage. With respect to lighting and some of the exterior articulation, to identify it as a bike station and create that element of wayfinding, we are proposing some signage by way of a blade sign, which would include a black wrought iron metal bracket and a medallion for bike station. Again, we have proposed some sizes, and we've been in dialogue with Jessica and speaking regarding sign ordinance and appropriateness of size of letters. I would suggest that this is not so much about brand as much as it is wayfinding in this case, such that we're inclined to, of course, acquiesce to the wishes of the commission with respect to both the materials of the signage and the size requirements.
And just so you know, we do not review or approve sign. It's a separate committee.
Okay.
It's a subcommittee, really, of HLC, so you'll have to get approval.
Okay. And at this point, again, we were hoping to make a suggestion and trying to seek feedback
you,
in terms
you won't
of...
won't get feedback from us.
Okay, fair enough.
Well, I'm sure he will.
We're still on television, yes? No?
I meant about the sign. Fair enough. You'll get plenty of feedback from the building.
Point taken. With respect to some of the other exterior details, you know, we do want it to look like a comfortable structure in the landscape, a permanent structure. And again, minimally detailed, but detailed with an element of quality. We were looking for an element of decorative lighting and sort of a lantern, again, signifying almost sort of a front porch. At the primary entry, we would have areas where we would mount for security cameras and other security mechanisms in place throughout the roof structure. Again, once from the inside, again, there would be lights that would be switched on. I believe, Todd, if it's appropriate, I think it would be a motion sensing lighting scheme for the inside, and I imagine that we could go ahead and arrange for exterior illumination to be set on a timer suitable with this.
As part of the bike station module project, what we continue to do as we have improvements to the city parking lots is to continue to keep the get the handicap accessibility up to code. So in the island where the bike station would be, it's actually off the page further down this way. We are proposing some access ramps. And we had one question for you. So this is, again, in the city lot 3 parking lot. As we move here, this is the Saks Fifth Avenue property. We do have easement to make ingress, egress alterations to the property. We did have a question, though, for the design for this ramp, is if we should just go with a standard concrete color or if we should try to match the color that's existing in the Saks Fifth Avenue, the pavers color. And that concludes our presentation.
Any landscape?
So for the landscaping, we don't have any proposed at this time. I know it was recommended for vines. That we would actually ask for feedback if there's other options as well besides a vine. And as far as the material, it's pretty much the hedge would be removed where the portion where we have to put the concrete pad.
Do you have photographs of that hedge?
Yes. If we go back to the original,
page one,
the,
I believe.
What I submitted back in August. Yeah. So this is the hedge that exists here now. Yes.
Okay. All right. That concludes your presentation?
Mm-hmm.
Okay. Questions from the commission? How about Commissioner Drury?
Yes, I'm completely unfamiliar with bike stations in general.
Mm-hmm.
Can you just explain briefly how they work?
Todd, would you like that?
Yes, for the record, Todd Boulanger, bike station.
Welcome.
Thank you. Basically, think of us as our organization wants to park bicycles, would like to support cycling, and one thing that often helps that is having a secure long-term place to put your bicycle. And we've been in Santa Barbara now many years with our original facility at the Granada Garage. And one thing you can think about is, you know, people need to park their vehicle, if it's a bicycle or car, many locations throughout the day in a city. And this is just an expansion of secure bike parking primarily to serve the transit users. Currently, there's typically anywhere from 15 to 25 bikes parked on ramps near the MTD station, and often there's theft and vandalism. And so we're trying to improve that amenity so more people use transit and also beautify the landscape without bikes hanging out everywhere.
So people show up and they have some sort of a key access or a...
Yes. You know, you're given a fob through membership, and that allows you access to any of our parking facilities.
Anything you put on the table becomes ours.
Welcome to the service, Philip. We'll send you your membership packet next week.
And so you stack your bike and go about your business, come back and take
correct.
It. Is
correct.
Is it open 24 hours?
It's 24/7 based on the RFID tag. And so that provides convenience and security for members. You know, it's very similar to a parking meter also.
All right. Thank you.
Okay. Thank you. Any other questions? Commissioner Lavoie?
No questions.
Arias? Commissioner Arias? No questions? Commissioner Winnick, any questions?
Oh, gosh.
No.
Question I have, I'm assuming that the if this gets approved and the bike station is put in, that the existing bike boxes would go away?
Yes, that's correct. All of them would be removed.
Okay. And then do you really need to have the bird stops on the roof? Is that some, I don't know where that sheet went.
Yeah, it's those
three of five off
pieces. Back that way. Could you pass those back, please?
Oh.
This one?
The building, do we have the building elevations back that you could put over there, please?
Oh, yeah, you keep that, and okay. Mr. Garza will pass these back. So the bird stops that are being proposed here, is that really essential to the success of the bike station?
It is not essential from our operations standpoint or essentially standard procedure.
Okay.
In that it was seen as a security measure to prevent occupation of the roof area.
Okay.
No, birds at all.
All right. Okay. Any other questions?
I do have one more question. How many bicycles does it hold?
We are
48.
About
30. 30.
30. Yeah. 30
bicycles.
Okay. Comments from the commission. We'll start with Commissioner Winnick.
I'm going to pass.
Commissioner Arias.
I'm going to be blunt. I don't like it. I think it doesn't fit. It needs somehow to be softened and all. As far as the bird on the top, if you were a bird, you'd be standing on the columns before you'd be landing flat on the roof. So I think the design isn't appropriate. Sorry.
Commissioner Lavoie?
We usually say you're headed in the right direction. Mm-hmm. You're not yet. I support the proposal and its location. I think it's a great idea.
Yeah.
But it's not an important building. It's an accessory building in a garden, in a landscape garden. So. Simplify.
That's enough.
Brushed aluminum is not allowed in the district. Period. Take off the window surrounds. Perhaps leave the base of the building. The stucco needs to go to the paving surface. No slab should be exposed below the stucco. So it comes to within an eighth of an inch. Or there's a detail that the building department, you could pry out of the building department that's used in the district when the plaster goes to the ground. It needs a gap.
An eighth inch gap.
Eighth inch gap. If you're going to accent the corners with a thing, make it just a square, simple, and make it a box rather than this very narrow parapet so that it reads from you'll be looking down on this building. You know, the Nixolite on the roof is not going to keep anything off the roof, really. I think the parapet's shallow enough that I don't think you'll have anyone sleeping up there. The light fixture needs to be traditional Hispanic design. Your hardware needs to be traditional Hispanic design, simple, but traditional. The red color is kind of interesting. The building color is fine. The base color could be muddied up a little bit. The building form is fine. It's nice and simple. Just keep it simple.
Commissioner Drury?
Yeah, I would agree with that. I think color of the paint around the windows could be removed. I think the suggestion is to drop that color to within about a foot or 18 inches of the ground and leave the windows floating in white. Is that?
Yes.
Yeah. And then, but still have the windows recessed.
Yes.
Mm-hmm.
I agree with all the other comments by the commissioners.
Commissioner Winnick?
I'll just concur with the comments I've heard. Thank you.
And the flat roof is still supported.
Yes. Yeah. Part of the simplification.
Okay.
Yeah. Well, yeah. Could I make another comment, please? I think the sign is ripe for being stolen. Whatever, it needs to be made of plate steel and welded, I think, or it's going to be gone. And is there any provision made for removing graffiti? Because it will be graffitied. Not by my crew, I understand. But, you know.
By your gang?
Yeah. But it will be. At downtown late at night, that's a problem, unfortunately. That's all. Thank you.
Mr. Chair.
Commissioner Rios?
I would like to see a landscaping.
Yeah, I was going to make that comment, so.
Oh, I'm sorry.
That's okay. Provide a plan showing landscape. And it's not necessarily a plan that is adding landscape. However, I do strongly recommend that you do add some landscape. But I need, the commission needs to know what's existing to remain and have it clearly called out and delineated as far as a landscape plan. Any other comments?
Yeah, I'd just like to make one comment. I'd really like the idea of this refuge for bicyclists downtown.
Nice. Okay, let me see if I can get all the comments summarized. Remove the surrounds at the windows, but keep the belly band.
That's right. Okay.
Simplify the building corner details, particularly at the parapet. Suggestion is to make those a square box. Provide traditional hardware and fixtures, traditional being the key word. Provide for graffiti removal. Provide a landscape plan. And there shall be no gap where the stucco meets hardscape.
Minimize.
I'm sorry. There shall be a minimal gap where stucco meets hardscape of an eighth of an inch.
Just minimal.
Traditional fixtures.
I said traditional hardware and fixtures.
Yes, thank you.
And Mr. Chair?
And begin with, we support the location and...
Yes. The commission supports the location and the proposal, the project's... the intent of the project. Supports the location and the intent of the project. Okay, did you have a question?
Did you want the belly band dropped, though?
No, I don't think the belly band needs to be dropped.
Well, it depends on their window details.
Need to the windows work.
You thought we're going to have another color, should be...
Actually, what's going to happen, it's going to line up there. That's fine.
Yeah, it lines up with the top of the display.
Yeah, that would work.
That's perfect. Okay, so no, the belly band. Just retain the belly band.
Great.
All right, so they encapsulate all those comments. I'll look for, the direction for the handicap ramp on the 16 West Carrillo Street side, my preference is to match the color of the pavement, the surrounding pavement, sidewalk pavement.
I would agree with that.
Not driveway pavement.
Mm-hmm. Match the...
Just a second.
And would that be colored concrete or...
Colored concrete. You can't do the pavers, I think, for that. Yeah, it would be colored concrete. So match the surrounding sidewalk paving for the ADA curb cut.
Is there a color on the truncated domes, too?
Terracotta.
Terracotta.
Yeah, okay. Thank you.
Right, I love it. So look for a motion with a timeline, please.
2 week continuance?
No, I think we need more because we need a landscape plan.
Yeah, I think we probably need to close to 4.
Indefinite continuance, then? So moved?
Mm-hmm.
So move for an indefinite continuance.
Second.
With those comments. So we had a motion. So we had a motion by Lavoie, second by Drury. All in favor?
Aye. Aye.
Opposed? Abstain? Motion carries. Meeting adjourned.
No, it's not.
No, oh, that's right. I'm sorry. Consent to calendar.
Yep,
consent
thanks.
To calendar.
Oh.
Thank you very much.
Thank you. You understand the motion? Yes. Okay. Okay, we are not adjourned, and we have the consent calendar to review.
It won't take long.
Great.
Just wait 1 minute.
So, Mr. Chair?
Yes.
Item A at 634 Santa Barbara Street was project design approval and final approval with the condition. Item B at 901 North Milpa Street was continued 2 weeks. Item C at 350 Chapala Street was project design and final approval was submitted. Item D at 436 State Street was project design and final approval as submitted. Item E at 117 West Mason Street was final approval as submitted of a review after final. Item F at 800 Cai Puerto Vallarta was final approval as submitted of a review after final. Item G at 509 State Street was project design and final approval as submitted. Item H at 902 Chapala Street was continued 2 weeks to the full board. Item I at 322 East Cannon Perdido Street was project design and final approval as noted. And item J at 1604 Olive Street was continued 2 weeks to consent. Those items were reviewed by Commissioner Sharp, except for items I and J, which were reviewed by Chair Suiting.
Do I have a motion to ratify the consent calendar?
So moved.
Second. Motion by Drury, a second by Winnick. All in favor?
Aye. Aye.
Opposed? Abstains? Suiting abstains from item H. I don't believe we have any other outstanding business. Meeting adjourned. Thank you, Commissioner.